Quest presents an unabridged recording of Legion 22, The Capsarius, by Simon Turney. Narrated by Colin Mace. Prologue. 1 year previously, Arabia Felix, the Lucky. Staring down at the stump that was all that remained of his left arm, legionary Titus Cervianus of the 12th Fulminata Legion lurched and stumbled across the darkened sands as though the very gates of Hades were opening behind him, leaving an intermittent trail of crimson glistening black in the moonlight. The burden, dragged in his good hand, occasionally burbled or moaned as it bounced off rocks or slid through the blood train. Concentrating as he moved, Cervianus focused hard on anything innocuous that crossed his consciousness to help take his mind off the dreadful pain or his very real danger. Not for the first time in the past quarter hour, or even in the preceding days, he couldn't help but wonder what god he'd crossed to end up in this situation. The blame had seemed initially to lie squarely with Aelius Gallus, the commanding prefect, for his ill-considered action, or perhaps with the great Princeps Octavian of Rome for ordering the expedition in the first place. Now, however, he knew different. Even if the gods weren't against them, others were. The orders from the man who effectively ruled Rome had come down to the prefect of Aegyptus the preceding year, a campaign to be undertaken to annex the Sabaean lands of Arabia Felix and their incense production centres, and to control by both land and sea the trade routes that supplied Rome with its expensive and rare spices. The 12th, based at cosmopolitan Alexandria, along with their sister legion in the province, the 3rd Cyrenaica, had been pleased, eager even, at the news. Prefect Gallus had spent months carefully preparing his campaign. At Arsinoe, where the Arabian Sea came closest to the Nile's lush delta, he constructed a fleet of ships large enough to carry a vast force past the endless wastelands, rocks and mountains that the Egyptians called Biau and the Hebrews called Sinai, across the narrow sea and on down the coast of Arabia. The legions had been drawn together in the north, leaving only two cohorts to control Aegyptus. There they had combined with an army of strange non-Roman auxiliaries, comprised largely of Egyptian cavalry units, Jewish irregulars, and Nabataean mercenaries from the deserts north of Arabia. A goat had been opened and read, and the omens pronounced good, and Gallus had smiled to the cheers of his men and given the command to depart. It had begun as a glorious and magnificent expedition, the valiant soldiers of Rome boarding bulky transports to the fanfares of the musicians and the cheers of the civilians. Cervianus himself had grinned like an idiot as he clambered down into the hold of the broad vessel, and along with his fellow legionaries found a place to sit among the supplies, grateful that they had not been allocated space in those ships that carried the horses, oxen and camels, as the unfortunate auxiliaries had been. Cervianus's thoughts whirled for a moment as he stumbled in the dirt, the gravel in his boots rubbing his feet raw and adding to his torment. He'd been warned by his friends to wear socks to prevent chafing, but the Arabian heat was just too much to even think about such apparel. Righting himself, he gritted his teeth against the agony of his severed arm, momentarily dropping the groaning figure, gripping his elbow and raising the forearm to prevent too much blood flowing free. His tourniquet must have loosened. A quick glance over his shoulder told him it was just about over. Now, it was all down to him. Taking a deep breath, he gathered a handful of the man's tunic in his fist and staggered on, hoping he had remained unnoticed. The catalogue of disasters that constituted Gallus's campaign had begun almost immediately. Rounding the tip of the Sinai, the fleet had encountered a freak storm at open sea and arrived battered and worn at the Arabian coast, only to discover that they would have to continue many leagues south along the rocky coast before finding a harbour where they could safely put in. Of the 130 ships that had slipped away from Arsinoe, fewer than 100 arrived at the port of Luz. And, as the men clambered wearily and distraught onto dry land, many had found somewhere quiet to make offerings, libations, or simple prayers to Neptune in fear or gratitude. Among the legions, resentment began to rise towards the prefect's Nabataean guide, Silius, who had insisted on this disastrous route as the best entry point to the fabled lands of Arabia Felix. The Nabataean official had remained in the confidence of Prefect Gallus, however, insisting that there had been no reasonable alternative. What had been planned as a week-long sojourn at Luz to allow time for any stray vessels to rejoin the fleet had then turned into months of waking nightmare as a sudden plague began to manifest itself among the men. An illness, perhaps contracted at home, and then spread in the cramped conditions of the ships, or possibly native to Luz, and virulent enough to move about the Roman camp like a sudden brush fire. The pessimists among the common soldiery, initially a minority that had now grown into the majority, proclaimed the campaign a mistake, doomed, and disfavoured by the gods. Truly, the size of Gallus's enormous force had almost halved by the time the disease had run its course and the segregation of the sick from the healthy had halted its spread. The army that left Luz the next spring, heading into the desert along ancient and mysterious nomadic trade routes, was a different force entirely to the one that had left Aegyptus. Brooding and dark, sick and tired, fewer than 7,000 men pressed on toward the fabled lands of Arabia Felix. The Nabataean Salius once more leading the way to the loathing of many. Terentius paused, his head spinning. The loss of blood was starting to affect him, and he was beginning to feel distinctly faint. Yet he had to press on, else all would be lost. Tearing off a strip of his russet-coloured tunic, he added an extra tourniquet, pulling it tight until the flow of blood slowed once more. Gritting his teeth, he glared down at the barely conscious man in the long brown robe and growled. Changing his grip, he grasped the man's long hair and used that to drag him across the rough ground. The next few months had been a blur of thirst, hunger, weakness, exhaustion, and despair, punctuated by occasional violent bloodshed when the army of Gallus came across a small town or settlement that confirmed they were in the lands of Arabia Felix and under the watchful gaze of the Sabaeans. The names of conquered towns went down in the prefect's wax tablets for later reports and to count toward the possibility of a triumph, though they meant little to the soldiers themselves. Neirani, Asca, Athrula. What constituted glorious expansion for Gallus meant the periodic loss of hundreds of comrades for his men. And then, finally, less than a week ago, they had reached the prefect's goal. The great mud brick, powerfully walled city of Masiaba, capital of the Sabaeans. Given the height and thickness of the defensives, and the almost unassailable rock upon which it sat, a direct assault would have been suicidal. Although a siege had seemed out of the question from the very beginning, the only water available being that which the army had brought with them on camels, there had really been no other option. The sparse dry wood in the area was largely unsuitable for the construction of siege engines, and as the army of Gallus created its perimeter and began to send out patrols, the water was placed under secure guard and the men put on half rations. Terentius glanced over his shoulder again. The camp of the Nabataean mercenaries and their Jewish companions lay brooding behind him, the torches and lamps twinkling innocently in the darkness.
Had they been in collusion since the very beginning? Or had their loyalty been only recently bought?
It had been less than half an hour ago that Titus Terentius and his companions had set out from the camp of the 12th on their routine patrol. The sentry, already under half strength, had tramped off on their route around the perimeter, covering a quarter of the circuit, where they would wait until the next patrol met them and exchange watchwords before turning and marching back.
"Pick your bloody feet up,"
the centurion had growled at him as they marched. Terentius, along with several of his companions, had grumbled quietly, glaring at their commander. It was hardly their fault that they were having trouble marching in the dark in this terrain. The other patrols had cut the route slightly short in order to stay on the low, flat ground below the walls of Masiaba. His centurion, however, ever the strict disciplinarian, had led them along the precisely ordained route, crossing crests of rocky ground and scree slopes, a decision unpopular with the men. A decision fortuitous beyond measure in retrospect. It had been at one particular rocky ridge when the centurion leading them had suddenly waved them to a halt and dropped sharply behind a boulder. A man at the back had opened his mouth with a question, but the optio, the centurion's second in command, had slapped him across the head and gestured him to silence. The 30 or so remaining men of the century had dropped into silent hiding among the rocks. Terentius had been close to the front, near the centurion, and rose to peer over the tip of the rock that obscured him. He had a moment to see a single lone figure on the sands, perhaps 300 paces from both the patrol and the nearby camp of the Nabataean mercenaries, before the centurion's massive fist gripped his sleeve and yanked him back down out of sight.
"Get down, you prick. They'll see you."
But Terentius was frowning. Something about the way that figure moved and the shape of his attire had been very familiar. He shook his head.
"What is it?" the officer growled quietly.
"That's Salius, the guide."
The centurion's brow furrowed.
"You sure?"
"Positive, sir."
Terentius nodded vigorously. Beside him, the centurion released his grip and rose to glance over the rock.
"Bugger me. You're right. The question is, who in Hades are those others behind him?"
Terentius and several of the other legionaries rose once more to peer over the boulders. The man was definitely Salius. There was something snake-like and hypnotic about the way he moved, and he was attired in a brown robe, typical of his people, yet elaborately decorated at shoulders and cuffs, and a strangely ill-fitting Phrygian cap. What Terentius had failed to notice at first glance was the group of men converging on Salius from the opposite side. More than 100 men, armour and weapons glinting in the moonlight.
"Them's Arab types," the centurion frowned. "Got to be Sabaeans. No one else around here that looks like that. The Nabataean bastards consulting with the enemy," the centurion snarled. "Screw the patrol. I think we need to have a little word with our friend from Petra."
A few paces behind, the optio cleared his throat. "Should we not report this to the camp straight away, sir?"
The centurion shook his head. "Come on. I want him intact to answer a few questions. We need to get him before he's in with that lot."
The soldiers drew their swords as one, checking their helmet straps and hefting their shields, gripping them tight in their left hands.
"Run!"
the officer hissed, rising from his hiding place. As silently as possible, the only noise the crunch of the rock and sand beneath their hobnailed boots and the slight shush of mail or clink of wooden shield, the surviving 36 men of the century rose from the ridge and ran toward the unheeding nobleman as he watched the Sabaean warriors approach from the city. The well-trained, disciplined and angry soldiers had covered fully half the distance from the rocky ridge to the lone figure before the alarm went up from the approaching knot of enemy warriors. A shout alerted the Nabataean, and he turned, his expression unreadable in the night, to see the men of the 12th Legion bearing down on him. With a squawk of fear, the guide whirled this way and that for a moment in a panic, then, settling on his objective, tore off across the sands towards the group of warriors, dust billowing up around his heels.
Faster! I want that bastard in custody!
The men reacted to the centurion's shout, finding reserves of energy of which they had been unaware, picking up speed to try and overtake the running man before he could reach the safety of his co-conspirators. With shouts of rage, the Sabaean warriors poured across the sands towards the Romans. Armoured in cuirasses of small interlinked bronze plates and with square plain shields of hide and barbed spears or slightly curved blades, this was Terentius's first sight of the enemy they had travelled so far to defeat. A quick mental extrapolation made it clear that the traitor would reach the welcoming arms of his Sabaean conspirators before the sentry could catch him. And Terentius turned to question the centurion on the wisdom of attacking a much larger force. As he turned, however, he realized that the centurion had pulled his dagger from his belt, gripping his sword with trouble beneath his shield arm. With a mighty throw, the officer hurled the short blade. The Roman pugio was a thrusting dagger, not weighted for throwing, but accuracy was not the centurion's objective. His aim was true, and the heavy weapon struck the fleeing nobleman on the back of the head, bouncing off into the darkness. Silius tumbled to the ground. The sense knocked from him, and a moment later the Romans ran across the prone figure and engaged the Sabaeans. Terentius raised his shield desperately as the glinting tip of a thrown spear reflected the moonlight long enough for him to catch sight of it and defend himself. The triple barbed point tore through the leather and wood, reaching 3 inches inside before it snagged and carving a thin scratch across his wrist. The weight of the spear projecting from beyond the shield was enough to pull the heavy object down and away from him. Gritting his teeth, the legionary let the useless shield fall away and instead drew his pugio from his belt, raising it just as the first warrior reached him. The legions had been drilled mercilessly even in the sun and terrible conditions on the desert march, and in full battle they would form into lines, defensive tortoises or squares, without the need for more than a wave of the standard. Precision and discipline, their overriding advantage. This was a different sort of fight, though, and Terentius was grateful not for the first time that his centurion was a hard bastard and had also drilled into his men the need to be able to react individually without losing that strength they gained from unit cohesion.
"On me!" the officer cried,
and the legionaries began to pull toward their centurion, each man fighting his own battle but equally aware of the general situation. The nearest Sabaean warrior swung his sword around in a tight arc, using all the space he had available, the sharp outer edge of the wicked blade slicing toward Terentius's ribs. Desperately, the legionary thrust down with his left arm, the dagger catching the swinging blade and sliding down the curved edge with a nerve-jarring screech, striking sparks that lit the night like small shooting stars. The warrior's eyes were wild, not with fear, but rather with something akin to rage. The man was actually smiling, 3 missing teeth making his grin somewhat lopsided and strange. With a jolt, Terentius's sliding dagger connected with the sword hilt and deflected the initial blow. As he lashed out with the gladius in his right hand, the man calmly knocked away the sword with his square wooden hide shield. For a fraction of a second, the combatants stared at each other, their arms both wide, but Terentius's training overtook him. A gladius was a weapon, and so was a dagger, and even a shield used correctly, but so were fists, feet, elbows, knees, and the crunch as he head-butted the Sabaean with his reinforced bronze helmet told him without further need of investigation that the man was already out of the fight. A broken nose would give a small crack, but this was the sound of shattering jaw and cheekbones. If the warrior was lucky, he might die from a random sword blow now. If not, the next hour or more would be an agonizing journey to Elysium for him, viewed through pulped eyes and a smashed face. Already Terentius had turned away from the falling man, fixing his eyes on the next target as he stepped in beside the centurion. Other legionaries were now gathering in the centre, though the number of Romans was slowly being whittled down in the face of the greater odds. A distant roar drew his attention momentarily, and he glanced off toward the Nabataean camp to see more armed men running toward the fray. These fresh warriors were, in theory, auxiliaries and allies of Rome, and yet the situation had changed. Silius's true colours had been revealed, and with them those of the entire Nabataean contingent.
"Shit, sir. There's a whole bloody army of them coming."
The centurion grunted his agreement as both men stepped forward, parrying blows and avoiding the thrusts of a spear from somewhere behind their current targets. Terentius lashed out and felt his blade tear deep into thick muscle, the enemy's shriek instantly lost in the barrage of wails and bellowed cries all around. In the impossibly low light, he couldn't even tell where he'd struck the man, but it must have been in the torso by the feel of it. With lightning reflexes, he ducked left at the very last moment as the barbed spear of another warrior scraped and bounced along the cheek and neck guards of his helmet, drawing blood from the very tip of his ear.
Crap! There were just too many of them. Where the one man had been in front of him just a moment ago, there were now three.
Manically, he stabbed again and again with his gladius, feeling the blows connect more often than not. His left hand waving defensively back and forth, the tip of the dagger occasionally touching something in the press. He cried out as something struck his arm, and looking down, he realized that his left hand had gone, the dagger lost somewhere in the dirt as blood pumped from his severed wrist. He gritted his teeth, trying not to scream, the shock and pain almost driving him to his knees and blessed unconsciousness. Suddenly he was being hauled backwards. Panic surged through him as he saw the centurion stagger back, the barbed point of a spear, crimson and glistening, protruding from between his shoulder blades. As Terentius stared in horror at the collapsing officer, the men around him pressing back desperately and fighting in an ever-tightening knot. The wounded legionary felt himself being hauled around again and found himself face to face with the Optio. The centurion's second-in-command was almost as long-serving a veteran as his commander, and with as much experience of battle. The shorter, stockier man, a black beard highlighting his gleaming white teeth as he grimaced, pulled Terentius to a standing position, holding him by the reinforced shoulder pads of his chain shirt. The legionary stared down at the constant stream of blood running from his stump. The Optio shook him ruthlessly.
"Listen to me, Terentius."
"Sir?"
He was bewildered, in shock and so much pain it seemed almost distant, someone else's wound.
"For Jove's sake, Terentius, listen to me."
Something about the familiarity of the situation, being bellowed at by the martinet of an Optio, snapped him out of his daze. Dragging his gaze from the grisly remains of his arm, he focused on the officer before him.
"Yes, sir."
"That's better."
The man paused for a moment and ducked, pulling Terentius down with him as a sharp spear passed through the space they had just occupied. The Optio wrenched him to the left and pointed at the undulating desert off to the east. Terentius stared at it in confusion. The deep grey-brown of the land met the deep purple of the sky in a haze, and it was hard to distinguish the precise shape of the horizon. He blinked, and his eyes refocused, his brow frowning.
"What the?"
"Sabaeans. Thousands of them," the Optio growled. "We've been betrayed and led into a trap."
"Oh, shit. What do we do?"
The Optio stared at him and shook his head sadly.
"What we do is fight these bastards here until the last Roman stands."
He turned, dragging Terentius round with him, hauled the unconscious form of Salius from the dust and thrust it at him. What you do is run back to the camp with this piece of shit and raise the alarm. The prefect has to retreat now or both legions are lost.
Legions? Lost?
The optio gave him a slap on the side of the helmet that rang like a bell. Go. If we fall, Aegyptus will be wide open. Defenseless. Shaking his head, Terentius turned and staggered away from the fight, dragging the treacherous Nabataean with his good hand. After a few moments, he paused to look back. The men of his century were gone. The optio appeared briefly, lunging into the air, and then disappeared among enemy warriors. Turning his back on the scene, grimly aware that he was the last survivor of a whole century of men, and also that he had to get his arm cauterized as soon as possible before he bled out, Terentius stumbled on toward the camp to raise the alarm and deliver the traitor. Arabia Felix, indeed. Which humorless god thought of that bloody joke? The one-armed legionary staggered on, the security of the eastern provinces riding on his shoulders. 6 months ago, Napata. Amanirenus, queen of Kush, daughter of kings, wife of kings, mother of kings. Beloved of Atum, of the curved horns, living embodiment of Usaset, rightful pharaoh of all the lands of the Nile, and general-in-chief of the Kushite armies, turned over in her bed, sweat soaking through into the sheets. She moaned in faint panic. The two enormous mute eunuchs who stood guard inside the door of the sleeping chamber exchanged a glance, uncertain whether or not to wake their mistress. If they did so and she was in one of those moods, they could be decorating spear points by noon for daring to interrupt her sleep. But then, if she was in one of those moods and she was having a nightmare and wished to be woken and they didn't... They were saved the anguish a moment later as the queen sat bolt upright in her bed, her one good eye flickering wide open, the empty socket of the ruined one darker in the shadows. The two guards quailed automatically. It was hard not to in the presence of the living goddess who ruled the High Nile.
Nedja! She bellowed in furious tones.
The two guards almost fell over each other to be the first out of the room and in search of the revered priest Nedja. The Kandake, the warrior queen of Kush, bit her quivering lip and forced herself to calm, dragging down her breathing. She reached up and ran a pointed fingernail down the long scar that bisected her eyebrow and had taken her left eye before leaving a cleft in her cheek and chin. It soothed her to do so, for it came as a physical reminder that it had been she who had walked away from that night, and not her opponent. Amanirenas was no stranger to night terrors. Indeed, they were like old friends, flocking to her in the darkness and swaddling her through the night. But this was different. This was not a dream of death or blood or the killing of kings. This was not searching for her eye or tying off her leg to save it from bleeding out. This was new. This was prophecy, she was sure. Carefully, she lifted her sheet and wiped the sweat from her face. It would not do to be seen as weak by the priests. She rose, nubile, lithe, the colour of old carob seeds, with hair of midnight black braided and tied tight around her brow. She was naked. She always slept naked. Her time of submitting to the lust of men was long gone with her husband, and no Kandake could hope to rule the world if she could feel shame just for the air on her skin. She was stretching and flipping her sword over and over by the time the priest arrived, watched rather nervously by the remaining guard at the door.
"My queen," Nedja said respectfully as he entered with an odd smile.
He did not bow, as the feeble northerners did to their emperor. Priests in Kush bowed to no one. Sometimes in the past, the rulers of Kush had even bowed to the priesthood, for those who spoke for the gods were the only ones in the world with the right to remove a person from the throne of Kush. She suspected that the current crop of priests, even Wily Nedja, would never dare try such a thing with her. But it was always a threat, and a good one, for it kept Amanirenas on her toes.
"I dreamed. It was a truth dream, I think."
Nedja frowned and leaned against the wall.
"The gods rarely send truth dreams to those who do not serve them."
Amanirenas gave him a withering look.
"I serve the gods more than most. More than many of your brothers, Nedja. Do not lecture me on the nature of dreams and the priesthood. Just explain to me this one."
Nedja nodded and gestured for her to go on as he fiddled with the tassels on his leopard pelt garment.
"I saw a ram. It was a ram and a man, in the way of Atum. He was standing upon the back of an elephant, surveying his domain, when an eagle plummeted from the sky and tried to carry him off. The ram was too heavy, and the eagle and the ram fought upon the elephant's back until both were wounded and exhausted. Then, finally, the eagle won out, raking the ram with its claws, and when it stretched out triumphant, its wings became arms, and it was not only an eagle, but a handsome young man." "What does this mean?"
Nedja cleared his throat.
"Rome. The time has come to face the great empire of the north and take back what is ours, Gandake."
"Explain."
"The ram, my queen, is Atum, who the northern Nile dwellers say is called Khnum. He is the ram god of creation, born, as we know, on the holy mountain outside this very palace. But he has another holy site for the Egyptians, at a place they know as Yebu, and the Romans call Elephantine, for it rises from the Nile in the shape of one of those noble beasts. The people of that land believe that Atum rose from that island, but now Elephantine is in the hands of Rome, plagued with statues of their emperor who looks down upon the gods. Atum will never be free from the eagle until that island is free of Rome."
Amanirenas frowned for a moment, then nodded.
"Rome has withdrawn many of its soldiers from the land to go and fight in Arabia. Egyptus is like an open basket of fruit, ripe and ready to be eaten. We will be all but unopposed. Go, Nedja. Tell Kalabsha to muster the armies. We travel north to Elephantine at dusk."
As the priest scurried off with an oddly self-satisfied smile, the one remaining eunuch guard who had stayed in his place in the room cleared his throat, emboldened by the energy and positivity of the queen.
"Kandake, will not Rome seek revenge if you enter their lands?" his eyes widened, as Amenerenas's sword punched through his front teeth, his tongue, tonsils, and neck, cracking the spine as it passed and pinning him to the wooden doorframe.
"Yes, Amma," she replied quietly. "I believe they will."
Chapter 1. Alexandria. The trireme, Fidelis, lurched and bounced across the waves. Sailors kept their feet with the confidence of veterans as they went about their tasks, the banks of oars dipping in time to the piper and forcing the vessel to creep forward slowly once again from where it had languished this past hour. Titus Cervianus, leaning against the rail in the prow, found himself jerked back, fighting to maintain his grip on the sturdy timber as the vessel got underway once more. Blinking away the spray thrown up by the oars, he glanced briefly back toward the rest of his sentry. The men were standing to attention in ordered rows at the center of the deck, the Optio and Centurion beside the formation, glassy-eyed and aloof. As usual, nobody seemed to greatly care where Cervianus was. It was at the same time both a curse and a boon, though he was grateful for his virtual ostracism right now as he leaned calmly on the rail, shifting his leather bag so that it stopped slapping against the timber. Better to be here and comfortably unpopular than standing in neat rows and trying not to fall over comically with every lurch of the ship. The fleet of almost 100 vessels had arrived in the waters surrounding Alexandria last night, guided true by the famous lighthouse that rose from its rock like a pillar holding up the sky. The decision had been made for the safety of all concerned not to begin the docking process until this morning, and even then the whole procedure had been so slow that many of the triremes had been required to produce lunch for their passengers before a jetty became available. It made Cervianus smile to see the vast number of merchant vessels flitting in and out of the city's great harbour, past the waiting mass of military ships, priority having been given to the traders that were the city's lifeblood. Only when the mercantile traffic eased here and there did a jetty become free, and one of the great triremes began to manoeuvre into position. Cervianus had enjoyed lounging around and taking in the atmosphere of the greatest city in the East during the interminable wait that had bored most of his companions, even though most of the place was not yet truly visible. Though the Fidelis was currently at the front of the queue, much of the city was still hidden by the great island of the Pharos, the mole, or the headland upon which the royal palaces stood. Here and there, tantalizing glimpses of the city on its hills appeared briefly as the ship rose and fell, giving momentary flashes of great, colorful colonnades and colossal buildings. But the sea air and the warmth of the roasting sun, mixed with the smell of spices and wood that accompanied the view of the great lighthouse, had served as a wonderful welcome and introduction to this land that had ruled a vast empire when even Athens was a mere collection of huts on a mound. He'd expected Aegyptus to be much hotter and drier than his homeland in Galatia. But at the moment, everything was just comfortably warm. Things would be different, of course, away from the coast and its breeze. Writers spoke of the oppressive heat in the interior. The ship lurched again, and Cervianus gripped the rail until his knuckles whitened. Behind him he heard a metallic crash as several of the legionaries lost their footing and collapsed in a heap. The sound of Centurion Draco's voice snapping angrily at them served only to widen his smile, though he carefully kept his face hidden from view, gazing out over the water. Even without looking, he knew that Draco was glaring at him. Once more, as he settled back into his comfortable position, Cervianus was grateful he'd had time to brew up a jug of ginger and raspberry leaf broth to allay the sickness that the bucking of ships always caused in him.
Had the other men of the second century shown the slightest interest in speaking to him, he might have brewed up two jugs, but still, listening to the sounds of those men who routinely ignored him being violently ill during the night had been surprisingly soothing. As the Fidelis picked up speed, the piped melody increasing in pace, he watched the city sliding past and the harbour entrance drawing toward him. Though he had never been here, he knew the layout of the great city so well that if he closed his eyes, he could almost see what lay within. His mind furnished him with an image of the carefully drawn map of the city he had been viewing only last night. His ability to read and to speak several languages, only one of the lesser of many reasons for his enforced solitude, had led to Cervianus cultivating a voracious appetite for books, as well as providing him with plenty of time to sate that appetite. On the journey, he had devoted as much time as became available to studying the geography and history of this mysterious land, and particularly of this great city that would be his home now for as long as Rome deemed it necessary. Most of the section of the metropolis that was visible from here, marching out along the coast from the centre to the east and the Canopus Gate, constituted the Jewish quarter, the largest concentration of that people outside their homeland. The eastern end of the city was therefore of little interest to the legion, and to the Roman administration, with the exception of the need to watch and control that ever troublesome race. His attention was drawn back to the direction of travel, as the great temple of Artemis swept away to the left and the harbour entrance raced toward them, the Fidelius's triarch having lined up his vessel perfectly for the approach. To the right, as the ship lunged forth, the magnificent Pharos rose up into the sky, a reminder that a man who was a god had laid the first stones of this city. To the left, the Diabathra swept away to land, an artificial harbour wall that enclosed one of the largest port complexes the world had ever seen. And then they were suddenly inside the reaching arms of Alexandria's great harbour. Regardless of the number of texts he had read in Greek or Latin, the images carefully transcribed and maps etched on bark-skin tablets, nothing had quite prepared him for this. Ancyra, where what was now the 22nd, had been based for decades, and the home of Cervianus and most of his compatriots, was officially a city, indeed a Roman city now. But the whole of Ancyra would fit into the enormous sprawling mass that was Alexandria many times over. Ancyra in its entirety could fit into Alexandria's harbour. The port was simply breathtaking, enclosing a body of water over a mile across in every direction, spotted with myriad vessels of all shapes and sizes. The Pharos lighthouse at the entrance stood on the tip of its great island, largely bare and connected to the mainland by the Heptastadion, a man-made causeway wide enough to drive multiple carts abreast. From there, the waterfront was a mass of buildings and people, jetties and ships, statues and temples, familiar in style and yet alien in architecture. Directly ahead lay a huge square building that was undergoing work, covered in scaffolding and men. The Timonium, a palace that Marcus Antonius had begun before his death. His rival and vanquisher, Octavian, was having the building reassigned and statues raised there in his own image to remove forever the taint and memory of that most unpopular Roman statesman. The Fidelis swung to the left, adjusting its course for one of the many dock areas, close to the Timonium and the busiest area of the harbour. Once again, Cervianus had to tighten his grip as he watched the jetty striding out into the water toward them, welcoming him to his new home. He smiled.
"Cervianus, you waste of space. Get in formation."
With a sigh, he gave a last look around at the city of Alexander. Still, no need to worry. The 22nd Deiotariana Legion had been permanently reassigned to the province, and Cervianus had 18 years yet to serve under the Eagle, so there would be plenty of time to explore the city and its wonders. Turning, he caught the look in Draco's eyes, a mix of disdain, distrust, and irritation, and hurried along the deck between the oarsmen. Falling in at the rear of the formation, near the Optio with his vine staff, Cervianus tried to hunch down a little and fit in with the formation. It wasn't easy. At over 6 feet tall, Cervianus was half a head above the next tallest man in the sentry, and a full head over most. Where the majority of the men of the 22nd were blonde or light-haired, and continued to grow moustaches or beards of various styles after the fashion of their Gallic ancestors, proud reminders that the Legion had not always been Roman. Cervianus was clean-shaven, with raven black hair. Adjusting the leather bag at his side, he became acutely aware that he was the only man not carrying a shield and pilum, his being stowed in the cart below with the rest of the sentry's equipment, standard practice in order to allow him quick access to the bag and room to work. He tried various positions to hold his arm and settled with resting it casually on the top of the bag until the optio nudged his elbow with the vine staff, sliding his arm down straight.
"Try and at least look like a pissing legionary, Cervianus."
Sniggers hissed from some of the men nearby, and the optio growled loudly.
"If any of you comedians think that's funny, I look forward to seeing you standing knee-deep in the latrines tonight. Get my drift?"
The sniggering stopped immediately, and Cervianus sighed quietly, trying not to attract any more attention. He became aware that the man next to him was watching him, his eyes straining left while his head continued to face forward, expressionless. The man was frowning slightly. He was new, a replacement for the unfortunate Lugulos, whose simple tombstone back in Galatia failed to adequately describe what they'd cremated after the bear had finished with him. Cervianus had seen the replacement a few times during the voyage, but both shunned and shunning company, he had remained separate as usual. The man turned his gaze forward again, still frowning. The centurion at the front started rattling out orders, but they were virtually inaudible this far back, particularly given the noises of the ship and the harbour around them, and Cervianus allowed his attention to wander again. The trireme was almost at the jetty now, slowing its pace, ready to dock. What would this new assignment mean for them? For him, in particular? They would presumably have a fortress of traditional Roman style now. There had been talk for the past few years about building one at Ancyra following its annexation. But the 22nd had been left in their former Galatian barracks for the time being, assuming they would soon be reassigned anyway. From what he'd read, Octavian's legions had a full range of facilities in their fortresses, including baths, hospital, shops, gymnasium, and even training centres. His attention was rudely drawn back to his current situation as the Fidelis thumped into the jetty, bouncing off and back again before slowing with the teeth-jarring noise of wood grinding on wood. The sailors threw ropes over the edge of the ship, where they were caught by tired-looking dock workers and fastened to posts.
"Right, you lot, look sharp. Follow me and keep in formation. No fraternising with the locals. Keep your eyes straight ahead and ignore everything but us."
Cervianus let out a gentle sigh again. There was little enough excitement and interest to be had in garrison life, and Draco was determined to knock even that out. The soldiers waited patiently, sweating in their mail shirts and bronze helmets, while the unarmoured sailors ran a boarding ramp down to the timbers of the jetty and secured it.
"First cohort, second century, advance!"
Ahead, the standard waved slightly as the signifier started to move. The musician blew the signal for slow march on his cornu, and the sentry began to move at a stately pace along the deck, down the ramp and onto the jetty. Cervianus waited patiently for the men to move, and realized with a start that the man next to him was giving him a sidelong, searching look again.
"What is the problem?" he hissed.
"Shut up and pay attention," snapped the optio behind, giving Cervianus a painful prod in the shoulder with his staff.
"And I can hear all that sighing," he added ominously, just as Cervianus took a deep breath.
Evandros, the bully in their contubernium, who had taken every opportunity for the last 2 years to make Servianus's life miserable and difficult, and who stood in front of him in the formation, laughed as he began to step forward. Servianus followed suit, grateful at least for the distraction. The half-speed march was not an easy step to master, used only for slow parades and ceremonies, and was particularly difficult on the ship and ramp, with the slight rocking motion and the slippery coating of the timber. Trying not to move out of step, he once more concentrated on the city, now so tantalizingly close. The stone quayside at the end of the jetty was thronged with people and activity, a strange-looking building behind rising over their heads. This much closer to land, it became disturbingly apparent that the tint of spice in the air that he'd smelled out to sea was actually the pungent aroma of horse and camel dung, sweetened with the scent of incense burning all over the city. It was a heady, slightly sickening mixture. Negotiating the ramp with care, the sentry, a column of 80 men, four abreast, began to make their way at parade pace along the wet timber of the jetty, closing on the quay. A surreptitious glance around without moving his head confirmed that other triremes were at jetties in the same port. Off to the right, a military vessel was just departing. The sentry it had carried now mustering on the stone paving ahead. To the left, another had just arrived, the creaking and groaning as it scraped along the timber, adding to the general din. No one spoke as the sentry entered the city of Alexander the Great, home of wonders, capital of the infamous Cleopatra, port city of the most ancient empire the world had ever known. Servianus was almost bursting with anticipation. The cornu player blew the muster command, and the men came to an ordered stop, standing to attention, while the centurion and the signifer conferred out front. The crowd hung back, several paces from the sentry, tense as though waiting to leap on them, but fearful and nervous. Servianus wondered whether they had tried to accost the first sentry that landed this morning, trying to sell them dates and sweetmeats. If they had, their fearful gaze was entirely understandable. He could imagine the reaction of the commanders. A figure appeared from the crowd, the citizens opening a path to make way for him as he moved out into the open with a strange swaying gait, like that of a great hunting cat. His head was covered with a white skullcap that fitted seamlessly to his dark brown hairless head. His eyebrows had been removed and replaced with painted replicas, his eyes accentuated with galena, and though clean-shaven, he sported a short, stubby, false beard made from what looked like flax. His torso was bare, dark and thin, with little to be seen in the way of muscle, while he wore a skirt of white linen with the pelt of a leopard tied around the waist as an overcovering. In one hand he held a strange staff of whitened wood with a twisted top, and in the other a gold censer hanging by three chains, white smoke rising from it as it swung gently. The man approached nonchalantly, swinging the censer and muttering in a low voice.
"What in Hades is this?" the optio grumbled.
As the man continued to advance, the optio stepped out from the rear of the column, his vine staff by his side, waving a hand and shaking his head.
"Piss off, fella. Don't need your help."
The man paid him no heed, seemingly intent on his swaying motion, the censer picking up a stronger swing. The optio stepped directly in his path.
"Look, fella, I'm a good religious man, but this isn't the time."
A voice from the front of the crowd cleared its throat and spoke nervously.
He must cleanse and bless you. Sobek watches all armies in Aegyptus, and his priests must tell him if you're a friend.
The Optio frowned. Well, I suppose we don't want to piss off this Sobek, then. Just don't try and involve my men. I'm watching you, he added, making a vaguely threatening motion with his fingers, pointing at his eyes. The priest turned with a complicated motion and began to sway along the line of men toward the front, continually muttering and wafting his incense, the Optio keeping pace with him, irritably. Realizing that he was temporarily free of trouble, Cervianus sighed again and rolled his shoulders.
Why are you always on your own, then?
Taken by surprise, Cervianus spun his head to see that the man next to him was still regarding him with interest. The legionary was considerably shorter than him, but powerfully built, broad across the shoulders and with a lantern jaw. His moustache was short and neat, a mousy brown.
They don't much like me,
the man shrugged.
Me either.
What's your excuse? It was Servianus's turn to frown.
All sorts of things. People say I'm bad luck. Some of the others even wash their hands if they touch me.
Evandros and his thugs make sure I remain as popular as a latrine sponge.
And, of course, I'm not quite as thick as pig shit, so they don't really understand me.
The legionary laughed.
Yes, I can see how you might have difficulty making friends.
Servianus narrowed his eyes.
You're new. A replacement for Lugoros.
The man nodded. Reassigned from the first century just before we set sail. Apparently, I'm a bad influence, and how did the Optio put it? Oh, yes. A disruptive, evil-tempered, and downright dangerous piece of shit.
Servianus shrugged. You should fit in well here, then, he said spitefully.
Again the man laughed. Rumour has it that your centurion's a real piece of work, though I find it hard to believe he can be much more of a bastard than Nasica. I think they're expecting him to either knock me into shape or crucify me before the week is out.
Servianus nodded despondently. And he probably will.
You might want to end our little chat there, else you'll find yourself in the same situation as me. He gestured to the soldier on the other side of the new recruit. Petrokorios was giving the pair of them a stare of mixed contempt and haughtiness.
Him? The bulky new man laughed. Hold this for me.
Servianus's brow furrowed further as he took his companion's pilum. In the flash of an eye, the man's arm shot out at groin height, and he gripped the observer, squeezing hard. The contemptuous legionary's eyes bulged and a high-pitched squeak escaped his lips while his face went white.
If I ever catch you looking at me again or even breathing heavily near me, I'll cut these off and send them to your mother back at the menagerie. You understand?
The legionary, his eyes dangerously bulbous, breath held, nodded vigorously. Letting go of the groin, the shorter man retrieved his pilum.
It's all about how you deal with people, he said with a smile. I like to be fairly direct.
Servianus blinked, his gaze lingering for a moment on Petrokorios, who had let his pilum fall away in order to grasp and soothe his painful crotch, causing grunts of irritation from those it bounced off before hitting the ground.
Eunuchs aren't popular in the legions, Servianus said quietly. Shaking his head as if to clear it, he stared at the newcomer.
I'm Titus Cervianus, Capsarius for the second century.
Xxii. Legionary with mental problems, apparently.
Cervianus grinned. I think that diagnosis is fairly sound.
Ha!
The two stood in silence for a moment, and then carefully returned their gaze to the front as the optio returned, smelling of incense. The officer fell into his accustomed position at the rear of the column, where he lashed out with his vine staff and delivered a ringing blow to the helmet of the wounded legionary beside them.
"Stop playing with yourself, Petrocorios, and pick that weapon up."
Servianus kept his face straight, his eyes watering with the effort of not laughing. Xxii made a tusk noise quietly. Ahead, the cornu sounded again, marking the order to move on.
Titus Cervianus, Capsarius of the first cohort, 2nd century of the 22nd Deiotariana Legion, blinked the dust from his eyes. Dust stirred up by the tramping feet of the rest of the Legion. The sentry had spent almost 4 hours standing in formation in the forum, gradually becoming more and more parched and bored and continually ogled by the locals, while waiting for the entire Legion to disembark. By the time the last sentry had arrived and fallen into their assigned position, the sun was already well on its descent toward the western horizon. Servianus had watched the officers of the Legion conferring at the front of the square before the mustered troops, and then engaging in conversation with an official in a toga, and had briefly wondered whether they intended to keep the Legion on its feet in the square until even the carts and mules had been brought up and made to stand to attention. Then, finally, another official had arrived, alongside a man wearing the decorative armour of a military tribune. A brief discussion had taken place, and the Legion had at last been moved off toward the eastern gate of the city. The marvels of Alexandria had occupied Servianus's attention and barraged his senses for only the first moments of the march, before the shimmering glare of the setting sun reflecting on the cloud of dust that enveloped the column made it almost impossible to see anything around him. He would miss the canal and the hippodrome, the grove of Nemesis, a few temples and the squalor of the Jewish quarter due to the eye-watering dust. He chided himself for the irritation he felt, given that he was only in the first cohort's 2nd century, with fewer than 200 men in front kicking up the dirt. What it must be like for those at the back with almost 5,000 ahead of them didn't even bear thinking about. For a moment it irritated him that the medical wagons carrying the dozen or so sick and wounded were back there in the worst of the dirt cloud and the baking sun. Back in the old days of Galatian rule, when the army answered to King Amyntas and the influences on command were of Greek origin rather than Roman, great emphasis was placed on medical care, and the carts of wounded men travelled separate from the army with their own guard, often slower, and with extra supplies and attendants. Not so when one followed the eagle. The legions of Rome placed the emphasis on speed and military efficiency. A wounded soldier took second place to one who could dig or fight. Again he shook his head and squinted into the strange orange glow that was formed by the low, glaring sun reflecting off the haze of sandy dust. It was no good brooding on things. His intense concentration and tendency toward introspection was yet another cause for his general unpopularity with the rest of the century. Indeed, the only time he could remember being remotely popular was during an outbreak of the flux last year, when the Legion was encamped near the north coast in Pontus. That it should take suffering bloody feces to make most people converse with him was either hilarious or tragic, or possibly both. Of course, the most adverse influence had been missing at the time, with Evandros spending most of his time squatting over a trench and hoping his guts didn't leave him. The simple fact was that Servianus was too good a physician to serve as a Capsarius, and he knew it. Trained by a Greek physician, and with years of private service, even in matters of surgery and herbalism, before his enlistment with the army of Galatia, his medical knowledge outstripped even the commissioned medicus of the Legion who ran the hospital unit and received a centurion's pay, let alone the rest of the field medics. Moreover, with his gift for languages and learning, he had quickly fostered the resentment of his peers, many of whom had only been taught to read and write what was strictly necessary for military service. All in all, he was as far removed from the common legionaries as he was from the centurionate, many of whom had also undergone a less than thorough education. But that wasn't the main reason for his virtual ostracism. No, indeed. As he'd intimated to Xxii, he was considered unlucky by the men of the second century. Pure superstition, of course. Distrust fostered into dislike by the carefully placed words of Evandros. Just because he'd stated on more than one occasion that not everything was made so by the will of the gods, and that some things could be explained with simple science and logic, rather than because Jupiter or one of the other Roman deities had a boil on his backside. As a physician, he could hardly believe otherwise. Oh, he didn't deny the gods, of course. There was room in the world, even in Servianus's world, for the gods. After all, where else could a man turn when he was crouched behind an earth bank while screaming Pontic archers tried to puncture him? It was just that more could be explained and achieved with human intellect than mumbling over a statue with an incense burner. Such opinion was not, of course, popular with the common soldiery. He'd learned this early on in his first year of service, after a discussion over the cause of fog with Petro Korios had left him lying in his own sickbed, having been severely beaten with a small iron statue of Neptune. A sudden inhalation of grit and dust led to an explosive coughing fit, which elicited another poke from the Optio's staff. "If I were you," a voice muttered, "I'd wait till that prick was alone in the latrines and jam that thing up his ass." Servianus turned to Xxii and stared. "Do you have a death wish? Keep your voice down." The other legionary shrugged. "He can't hear us over the noise of the march. He wouldn't even know we were talking if you hadn't turned round." "Shut up and march, the pair of you." Servianus faced front again, but a sidelong glance afforded him a view of the grin plastered across Xxii's face. The Capsarius sighed deeply. The strange man was the first person to even offer an overture of friendship in the last year, since Lugudos, in fact, whose brief attempt to befriend him had been quickly forestalled by the others. It would certainly be nice to have someone to speak to at times, and someone to have your back, as they said, was always useful, but something about Xxii worried him. The man did not seem to have any realization of just how irresponsible and dangerous he was being. The Optio would kick 7 shades of shit out of a man just for looking at him in a funny way, and the Optio was a cuddly kitten compared to Draco. Being seen to be too close to Xxii could very well be hazardous to one's health. It was a puzzle he would have to think on, whether the pros of camaraderie outweighed the cons. Like so many things in Servianus's life, even friendship came down to a mathematical equation. A gust of wind sprang up, seemingly from nowhere, the first he'd felt since arriving at Aegyptus, and wafted the dust cloud away from the column. For a long moment, Servianus blinked, able finally to see ahead, past even the tribunes, standard-bearers, and musicians. The sun was now almost at the horizon. He daren't turn to check how low, else he'd provoke another prod with the Optio's vine staff, but the shadows the men cast on the beige landscape were long and thin. The heat was beginning to wane as the sun sank, and the land began to feel more like home. Somehow, during that hazy brown eternity that was the march from the city's forum, they had passed unheeding through the Canoptus Gate, by the Hippodrome, and past most signs of cultured civilization. Here, houses formed slums that huddled close to the glory of the great city. Mud brick structures with reed roofs that spoke eloquently of extreme poverty. The paved street continued out beyond the city. But this far beyond the walls, the road was only discernible among the grey-brown grit because of the slight camber. Blinking in the suddenly clear air, he reached up with his free hand and wiped the encrusted dirt from his face. Most of the sentry wore their helmets hanging on their backs, their green scarf providing the main head covering.
a simple concession to the heat allowed by the commanders, but Servianus's helmet was stowed in the baggage along with his shield and pilum. He wiped the sweat from his neck and failed entirely to sympathise with the bully in front, who had salty water gathering in the bowl of the helmet hanging on his shoulder. The land to the east of the city rose imperceptibly at such a low gradient that Servianus hadn't even been aware they were climbing until the breeze afforded by the combination of height and proximity to the open sea had cleared the dust cloud. In fact, the breeze was stirring up more dirt, but this remained at knee level, allowing the entire column to heave a sigh of relief. The houses, if one were generous enough to call them that, thinned out as the road climbed, until finally, as the march levelled out once again, the view was clear to both sides. Off to the left, perhaps 300 paces away, the land fell into a sharp slope that ran down to meet the sea, glittering white and perfect blue in the last rays of the sun. Various monuments that Servianus had been unaware of, even given his study of the area, dotted the coastline, each holding their own enigma that he couldn't wait to unravel as soon as duty allowed him time. On the other side, though he had to peer past Xxii and two others to see it, the land sloped down very slowly for the best part of a mile, past the canal, and to the Merotis Lake. It would have been nice to set eyes on the Nile, that most ancient and majestic of rivers. But this far out of the delta, only tiny streams would be found, the main channels lying away to the east, where the ground would be green and lush instead of brown and dusty. With mild surprise, as his gaze moved back to the left, Servianus saw Aulus Vitalis, the senior tribune and effective commander of the legion, ride out of the line alongside the other officer who had joined them in the square. The pair sat together for a while on the rise as the legion filed slowly past, gesturing with sweeping arms and having what may have been a deep debate, but looked to Servianus a great deal more like a fiery argument. The column crested a low hump in the road, and as the heads in front dropped out of the way, Servianus, his height giving him an extra advantage, got his first look at their destination. Here, perhaps 2 miles from Alexandria itself, what appeared to be a partially constructed city lay in a dissembled state. Off to the left, on the highest point and close to the sea, stood a low embankment with a solid, military wall complete with towers and parapet along only one side. The other defences standing to less than shoulder height at best and covered with wooden scaffolding. Servianus gave a small smile. This was surely one of the new fortresses that had sprung up in the past few years, just like those he'd read about in the West, possibly even with a hospital. This would be the home of the 22nd, then. He was a little surprised to find it under construction. He'd assumed it would be an extant building, or that the Legion would be building their home from scratch. But the fortress was far from alone. A great monumental forum was taking shape perhaps half a mile further on, temples of the Roman triad almost complete with their columned porticos and roofs, awaiting only the paint and decoration. What appeared to be a bathhouse was also almost finished, along with a partially completed channel diverting water from the Alexandrian canal to the new settlement. The most complete monument by far was the triumphal gateway, a triple arch of marble, elegant and strong, covered with friezes and inscriptions, and topped with a gilded statue of the Princeps Octavian in regal pose. It seemed that everywhere one went in the Republic these days, the nephew of the great Caesar was busy looking down on you and reminding the people of his victory over Antonius.
"Looks like Alexandria's in for a challenge, eh?" Xxii grinned. "Probably too Greek for Octavian."
Servianus contemplated commenting, but merely nodded. That was clearly the intention. A glorious, beautiful, strong city on a hill, overlooking that metropolis that had supported the Princeps' enemy.
"There's the 12th, look."
The Capsarius risked a glance around. Xxii was pushing his luck, chatting in line. The optio, however, unnoticed by Cervianus in his studies, had left his position, presumably on some task back to the next century. Relieved at the sudden freedom from the ever-watchful officer, he frowned at his companion.
The 12th?
Xxii grinned.
Nobody tells you anything, do they?
Come on.
The shorter, bulky man shrugged.
The 12th Fulminata. They are the current legion assigned here.
Servianus's brow furrowed further.
We're sharing the place, for now. Rumour has it they're being reposted to the east soon. Rumour has it that we weren't supposed to be brought to Aegyptus yet. Not until they'd completed this place and were ready to ship out.
The Capsarius shook his head in exasperation. And everyone knows all this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.